Frozen Tundra Football League.
Project.
That's it. Oh my gosh, that was such an amazing night. We got so many great.
Never mind the amazing sounds. Did you find anything? Did I lose something?
Did you lose something?
Yes, of great importance.
Wait, I don't know. I mean, what are you looking
great
for?
Great Scott! This could be disastrous. Catastrophic.
What could be disastrous? What?
Never mind. You don't need to know. I gotta go.
Ha! Welcome back to all of my friends and fellow FTFLers. It is I, the owner of the now most dominant team in the league, Hulkamaniacs, the host of this program, the FTFL Weekly Update, the true king of the FTFL, and lest us not forget that song deep down in your heart. That's right, it is I, Brett Sieber, and boy, oh boy, we are now 1/3 of the way, and I know there's people in Browerville going, hold on, Brett, 4 out of 13 is not quite, I know, we're close. Almost a third of the way through the season, 4 games down, 9 games left to go in the regular season, and let's be clear, at this point, no guarantees going forward because we did have our very first game this week. The Titans versus the Steelers postponed. Of course, that had ramifications for John's team. Kansas City and New England got moved from Sunday to Monday. The Titans still have players testing positive. A second player tested positive in New England. Things are starting to happen. Will that affect the NFL, our league? That is yet to be seen. So far this season, 4 weeks in, only 2 teams are below 500. Not bad. Only 2 teams below 500. That is, of course, Andy and Swart, both at 1-3. If you're in the South, you're in a good place because you have Ryan Deason's fantasy football team at 3-1, and then every other team is at 2-2, just a game out of first place. Of course, anyone's game at this point, even though some teams were allegedly throwing their season. Now, the argument can be made. Was I making improvements? Was I for this year? Was I planning for next year? Was it both? I don't know, but it continues because another trade for the Mixing Cocktails this week, they said goodbye to Michael Gallup and a 10th round pick and welcome Christian Kirk and a 4th round pick. And wouldn't you know it, Christian Kirk, he had the better week this week. Interesting trade. So the Mixing Cocktails not only continue to change their team, they finally get in the win column. There are also no more undefeated teams. I said that only 2 were, you know, below 500. No one now undefeated. The Ryan Deason fantasy football team tasted defeat for the very first time this week. And with that, it's off to the games we go. First up, the Hulkamaniacs coming in at 2-1, taking on Mana, 3-time Lucky Pants champ Mana, for the second time in this very young season, going for the first sweep since 2010. Of Jeff Markser. And oh yeah, baby. Woo! we got it. Uh-huh. Yeah, 128 to Marks' 78.5. We dug a hole, kicked him in, and then covered him up. Aaron Rodgers continues to look just awful, terrible, washed up, beaten down, and broken. Oh, this week to the tune of 30 points. That's right. George Kittle, welcome back, and thank you, 25.5. Chris Carson comes back after last week's scary, cheap tackle by the Cowboys for 19.5. Evans, 17.5. Kamara, 13.5. Woo! Highest scoring team through 4 weeks. This Hulkamaniacs are absolutely running wild. If you're Marks' team, you know, Josh Allen, who was better than Aaron Rodgers. But not this week. He only got 22 points. Rodrigo Blankenship, that's right, Rodrigo was Jeff's second highest scorer with 14. They were the only two in doubles. Nick Chubb, 2 points, is now on the IR for at least 3 weeks. Dak Prescott on the bench with 42 wouldn't have necessarily mattered. And really, Jeff's team this week, all across the board, underperformed. Both running backs and all three wide receivers all had scores that were below their average for the season. That adds up to a second loss to me in just 4 weeks. I now am in first place all by myself by one game, and I own the tiebreaker over Jeff. Since 2017, I haven't started 3-1. Now, that year, I did go start 5-1. And only won 2 more games the rest of the way. I hope it's a little bit more like 2003 if you catch my drift. All right, moving on now to a team that was at 1.2-0, falls now to 2-2. That's Linkowitz coming in at 2-1, taking on the previously winless Mixing Cocktails. And last week we talked about how Andy's team was it the key that they were just underperforming. Both his studs, Lamar Jackson and Joe Mixon, were playing below the standards they set in the second half of last season. Welcome back to both of them. 113 points for Andy, only 65.5 for John. Mixon blew it up this week with 33, Lamar Jackson 26. The Rams defense got 14. Cole Beasley got himself a start and tacked on 9.5. DeAndre Swift with 10, CeeDee Lamb 22.5. Two rookies on Andy's bench as he continues to look towards the future. He won't end up keeping both of them. 10 and 22.5 respectively. It didn't matter. He didn't need him. If you're John, Cooper Kupp had one play late in the game that netted him 12.5 of his 16.5 points. Tyreek Hill got 12. Ronald Jones, a second waiver wire pickup because of Derrick Henry, because of Tariq Cohen, because of Saquon Barkley. The list goes on and on and on for John. He dropped 11. No one else, though, for John's lineup was above 5. Matt Ryan, which, by the way, is John's only quarterback on the roster, which is weird because John usually carries 2, if not 3, only had 4 points. And round of applause, Gunner, and I'm going to chop this last name up. I apologize to all my Polish friends out there. Olchowski, got a catch. It was a weird catch that wasn't even thrown to him, but he did net a half a point. First fantasy points for him. Well done, young man. Now, if you're John, you've lost 2 in a row, and I'm here to tell you, it's not maybe going to get better before it gets worse. John came into this week with the highest efficiency, as he leaves this week, sorry, with the highest efficiency rating in the league, meaning he's getting the most out of what he's putting in the lineup. And that's not enough. John's gotten bit by the injury bug. Of course, COVID this week with the Titans. We'll see if John can get back on the right side of things next week. But for now, it's on to the Ryan Deason Fantasy Football Team coming in as the last undefeated at 3-0, taking on the fake king of the FTFL at 1-2. Of course, the king lost and then won and declared, "I'm back, baby." And then he lost. And this week, he wins again, 122.5 to Ryan's 91.5, and has already declared he's back, baby, for a second time in this very, very young season. OBJ had himself a coming-out party, 38.5 points. DJ Shark with the late touchdown, 10-pointer, 22 points. Dalvin with 21. Ryan Fitzmagic put in 16. Calvin, the newly acquired Ridley, big fat goose egg, 0 against the Packers defense. That's what you get. Austin Eckler, half point. Looks like maybe his hamstring tore smooth off the bone. I'm not entirely sure. He's going to be gone for a long while. He does have Gibson and Connor on the bench. So there is some help there. However, we'll see. If you're Ryan Deason, I mean, everything was looking really great up until this week. 91.5 is not a whole lot to sneeze at, but Patrick Mahomes put 16. Kareem Hunt, who's got a bigger role ahead of him with Nick Chubb being out, with 16. Allen Robinson II, 15.5 points. In weeks 1 and 2, he had a combined 10 points. In weeks 3 and 4, with Foles at the helm, he has 38.5 points. I'm sure he is helping Trubisky pack those bags and buying him a ticket to wherever he wants to go and stay there. Aaron Jones with 14.5, and we will will update the list just a little bit later on when we get to the other two players that are a part of our research that we've got going. Jerick McKinnon, 15.5, new pickup for Ryan on the bench. Wouldn't have mattered. Promptly, really, after telling Sid to take a seat, Sid says, sure, I'll take a seat and I'll shove your ass in it. That's what he did. Sid owns the overall record here, 22-20-1 over DeSim over the years. Now, before we get to the last couple games, recently there has been a whole lot of chatter about the DeSim Award. A whole lot of chatter about what is deserving and what isn't deserving, and a whole lot of chatter from one individual, all sorts of butthurt over the fact that he got the DeSim Award. Now, again, I didn't vote for you, but I've been down the road of crabbing and whining over the DeSim, and I ain't hearing it. And I'm telling you, here on the FTFL Weekly Update, when you piss and moan a little too much, I have to put in a phone call. And if I were to put that phone on speaker, you'd hear these words: don't be salty.
What would we be if we didn't have the classic elements of earth, air, fire, and water? All four of them make up who we are. Wouldn't it be amazing to be one of the four Ninja Turtles? How about living in a state where there's four beautiful seasons? Going through high school, the four best years of your life. And even better, the four beautiful years of college. Finding a four-leaf clover would wish you luck upon your years. Man, I tell you what, great things come in fours. How about if you had four first-round draft picks? What would that look like for your fantasy football season? Yes, you could probably dominate throughout the year, scoring points after points, pushing your opponents off to the sides, because you had four first-round draft picks of 10, almost 50% of the first-round draft picks. You could do a lot of damage. You could almost have your whole team built, plus the two that you already have. So 4 plus 2, that's 6. You pretty much have your whole roster put in place. But yet, sometimes in life, great things don't come in fours. Because you could push yourself to the limit and make it to the playoffs between four great teams. Then there's two. And out of those two, what would happen if you had four first-round draft picks? We all get it. You got the DeSim Award for having four draft picks in the first round of our fantasy football season. And you still couldn't make it happen. You could walk away from a draft and still win the fantasy football bowl. You could have other people pick for your team and still win the fantasy football bowl. But sometimes when you have four first-round draft picks, it doesn't make a difference. Schwart, love you, bro. But for Pete's sakes, bro, don't be salty.
I told you, man, you can't really be talking like that. It happened. We're moving on. Then again, are we? Are we moving on? Or is it just your second year in a long campaign of what will be most likely consecutive DeSim awards for you? Only time will tell. Moving on to the next game, the Architect coming in at 1-2, taking on the Monkeys at 2-1. Architect, Monkeys, back and forth, back and forth. Architect wins 105.5-81, putting them both now at 2-2. Again, two of the four teams in the South that are 2-2. Derek Carr, 18. Adam Thielen, 18. Fuller, 15. Ezekiel Elliott and the Cowboys, who Dak Prescott is putting up massive numbers. Elliott is doing good, but boy, I think he could benefit from a little bit more or a little bit less coming from behind, because then they're just throwing the ball all the time. Devin Singletary, 12.5, actually scored a touchdown. Josh Allen didn't run a touchdown in this week, at least all of them in this week. Devin did get one. Terry McLaurin, 11 points, one of the few bright spots in Washington. Only three of Matt's players were in singles. Usually that means you had a good week. For Salty, Kyler, Stupid Face Jr., Murray with 24 points. Mark Andrews, 15.5. James Robinson with a mere 8. However, not the lowest of our trio this week. The newly acquired Michael Gallup only got 1. Christian Kirk, 7.5. Whoops. And there went your 4th-round pick. I know it's early, but whoops. Golden Tate, 2 points. That's right. His 2 receivers scored 3 points. He lost. Brady on the bench, 36. Judy on the bench, 15. Those two, swap them in for a quarterback and a receiver, and you win. And you're 3-1. And you have a share of the lead. But that's not how it went. And so we move on. Last game of the week, the Pack Attack coming in at 1-2, taking on, also at 1-2, the DeSim award-winning visitors from Planet B with questionable motives. The Pack Attack gets themselves a much-needed victory to keep pace in the South, 107-96. Oddly enough, that 96 could have been higher. More on that in a moment. Melvin Gordon, 23 points for Eric on a Thursday night. Amari Cooper, 22. He was averaging 8.5. He totally showed up this week, getting in on that passing attack in Dallas. Russell, Stupid Face Wilson, looks like he ran out of ingredients. Only 18 points this week. The tight end from Dallas, Schultz, anyone? Who dis? Who dis, really, is what we should be doing here. He got 12 points, not bad. However, the most notable player on Eric's team actually had one of the lowest scores. His name? Clyde Edwards-Hiller. First round draft pick, not even first overall pick of the 2020 FTFL lead draft, Clyde Edwards-Hiller. After his 7.5 points, you will see he is sitting at a mere 39, almost doubling him up, is my boy, Aaron Jones, at 75.5, and a very respectable second, James Robin, at 53. 4 weeks in, this thing is getting out of hand in a hurry. Clyde, you better call somebody, because boy, oh boy. If you are Plan B, not a whole lot. I mean, I shouldn't say not a whole lot, but when your kicker is your leading scorer, we know we got problems. Randy Bullock was a free agent pickup, dropped 18. Todd Gurley had a somewhat decent day at 16.5. Drew Brees, 16. Mike Davis, another waiver wire pickup when McCaffrey went down. He has performed splendidly. 14.5 points in McCaffrey's absence. Kenny Golladay sighting, 12 points for Golladay. San Francisco, who is the defense that Swart started, 5 points. The defense that Swart didn't start was Kansas City. They got 20 points. Now, if you remember, when they were talking about whether or not the Kansas City-New England game was going to happen, the discussion have moved in the direction, you better have someone in place just in case, so spend the dollar. So we did, and he left San Fran in, and he kept Kansas City out. The difference, let's see here, 96 plus 15, 106 plus 5, 111. Did I get that right, Browerville? That's right. You would have won. You would have moved to 2-2. Instead, you fall to 1-3. All right, it's time for the stud, the dud, and the decim, and then we're getting up out of here. Stud of the week, OBJ, 38.5 points in a winning effort for Sid Hagen, the king of the FTFL. Honorable mention, Mixon, 33. Rodgers at 30, both getting their team's wins. The dud of the week, probably Markser's running backs and receivers, all 5 of them underperforming this week, definitely led to his low. Remember, he came into this week 3 consecutive weeks of 100-plus points. He didn't get that this week, and he also didn't get a victory. Other dud for the week would be Calvin Ridley. However, his team won, so we're not going to quite give that to him. This week's reason why Adam Swart should get the decent is, of course, he started San Fran over Kansas City. Matt picking up a kicker whose game was postponed is comical, because Matt and his kicker saga is just pages deep. However, I give the nod to Swart, as we probably should each and every week here on the FTFL Weekly Update. As we look ahead to Week 5, here are the games. Pack Attack at 2-2 coming on. Take on the Architect at 2-2. The King of the FTFL at 2-2 taking on the Monkeys at 2-2. That's right, all 4 2-2 teams in the South battling this week. week, seeing who comes out of that with a leg up and who is looking for answers when week six comes calling. The Ryan Deason Fantasy Football Team at 3-1, taking on a long rival of his team, Linkowitz, at 2-2. Manah, three-time Lucky Pants champ Manah, coming in at 2-2, taking on the visitors from Planet B with questionable motives at 1-3. And lastly, but certainly not leastly, the league-leading Hulkamaniacs at 3-1 in the Brother Bowl, taking on the Mixing Cocktails at 1-3. Until then, my folks, that's it. This is Brett Sieber signing off on the weekly update. Until we see you again, peace!
Help me for a second.
Oh, yeah.
Can you, that red sensor that's on the ground right there, can you grab that, pick that up for me, please?
Oh, sure.
Awesome.
What you doing over here?
Well, I'm doing a little bit of an experiment. I work in a nature center, and we're doing this owls in your neighborhood, so I'm trying to get a little speaker set up in here to get some recordings for, you know, to see who's here.
Oh, very cool. I'm a bit of a scientist myself.
You are? What do you study?
Oh, this and that. It's some interesting times you live in around here.
Yeah, you know, it's, what do you mean, I'm living in, we're all living in it, and it really is kind of weird, but we're doing what we can. Yeah, so I'm spending a lot more time at home. A lot of my work is at home now. All right, I think that should probably do it, so. Where did he go? He dropped some, what is this? Up. Man, I can't lose. This is good. Call Andy. Hey, Andy. Hey, yeah. Question. You know, it's draft time is coming. Are you still interested in getting rid of some of your keepers? All right, cool. What's it going to take to get Kamara?